in comic books, cause I don't wanna look at nothing. This world's too much. I swallowed all I could. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Niko's Comic Book Hauls and Reviews. And this is the first episode of hopefully many more to come. I hope to do these things monthly. Today, I'll be discussing my comic book haul, all the books that I hauled for the month of December 2020, as well as giving you some reviews on some of the books that I have read that I ended up picking up in the month of December. This is just a way for me to be able to not only discuss comic books, which I love and have been collecting for just over about 10 years now since getting back into the hobby, in my mid-20s. I kind of fell off when I was a teenager, started reading when I was young, around 6 or 7 years old, read till I was about a teenager, then fell out of the hobby for quite a while and then got back into it. And I've been going pretty strong and steady since about just over 10 years back now. So I am a big collector of collected editions, omnibuses, oversized deluxe hardcovers, the nicer editions of stuff, as well as, trade paperbacks as well, box sets, anything like that. You're going to actually see probably a little bit of everything here today. But I do pick up a lot of collected editions of comics, as well as I read, some single issue comic books as well. So kind of just everything across the board here. I'm a huge fan of comics, and I love talking about them. I'm part of the Late Night Chat Network of podcasts. We have our own YouTube channel here that you're watching this video on now. If you're new to our channel, you like this video, hit that like button, hit that thumbs up for me. Let us know what you thought about this video in the comments, maybe ways that could improve these moving forward for you guys. Let us know if you enjoyed the format of this video. Also, check out maybe some of our other videos that we do. I do most of the other videos on our channel here with my buddy JT and co-host on the Late Night Chat Show, which we do live on Mondays at 8 p.m. every week. We have, live chat and everything going, and we do a bunch of other types of shows and podcasts here on our YouTube network. So definitely check that out. But if you're in it more for the comic stuff, this is definitely where you're going to find that. So hit that notification bell if you want to be notified of more videos like this one that I hope to do monthly. Today I'll be discussing my haul and reviews of comics that I've read throughout the month of December for the collected editions that I ended up picking up. Well, let's get started without further ado, though. Basically, I'm going to be talking about three different piles of books here today. There's going to be the books that came out in December 2020 that I did end up reading. So I'll not only show those books off, then give you a quick review of that. There's the few books that I didn't end up reading that came out in December of 2020. And then also there's the books that I ended up picking up this month or receiving some as gifts because, Christmas was in December that I haven't got around to reading. Or they may be things that I've read that just didn't come out this past month. They're not new releases, but fairly new for the most part, and I wanted to kind of show those off as well here for you today. Okay, so we'll get started with ones that I did read that came out in the month of December 2020. First off, we got here Shazam. This is the Seven Magic Lands, written by Jeff Johns, mostly drawn by Dale Eaglesham. He had a couple other artists on here, Scott Collins, Marco Santucci, who's really, really good, and I believe I'm mostly new to his work. At least I don't recognize his name, but I definitely will be looking out for his stuff moving forward because he did a great job on the stuff that he drew in this. This is fun. If you like the Shazam movie, which I actually thought was one of DC's better films that I watched, I ended up enjoying it. It was fun and funny. I think you definitely like this. This involves the rest of like his extended family of all the orphans that become basically the Captain Marvel family. Of course, they can't call him Captain Marvel in the comics anymore. So when this kind of was coming out initially, I had heard some people comment on how it was weird because these characters weren't really in continuity at that time. But of course, maybe now with more of the DC's recent events, they are back in continuity. It doesn't really matter to me either way. This was just a fun story that Jeff Johns did with these characters. And there's, like I said, there's some great artists throughout, especially Dale Eaglesham. And it collects the 13 issues. issues of the Shazam series that Geoff Johns had written, and now I believe there is another writer that jumped on after Geoff Johns left the book. But this was a fun collection. If you liked his Justice League New 52 backups as well, maybe his take on the character. I know some people didn't love his take on Billy Batson. He kind of came off like a a pretty big dick, I remember, in those Justice League backups that he was doing, and some people didn't really like him. But in this, he's kind of lightened up a bit. He's kind of, you know, he's living with all the other, kids that I guess were orphans that that they were adopted all by the family, and they're all living together, and they all have magical powers, the six of them. So it was a lot of fun. So Shazam and the Seven Magic Lands, definitely check us out if you're a fan of any of those things. Okay, next up we got Captain Marvel Volume 4. This is written by Kelly Thompson, and the artist on this one is Corey Smith. Corey Smith, I think I first came across his work when he did actually a book for Dynamite Comics. He kind of relaunched Magnus Robot Fighter for them, and I know that wasn't like a hugely popular book probably for a lot of you guys, but that is probably, I think, the first time I came across his artwork, and he's been popping up here and there now. On some different Marvel stuff lately, bouncing around, and I've always really enjoyed his work when I have seen him on a title. So Corey Smith doing the art on this this arc, this collected issues 18 to 21, as well as the Empire 2, which Captain Marvel was a big part of. I will say, although I've been enjoying Kelly Thompson's run on Captain Marvel, this volume was probably maybe the weakest of the volumes so far that I've picked up in trade paperback, only because it was so tied into Empire, and I didn't read Empire, wasn't as interested in that event. I read a couple of tie-in things that kind of went through the books I regularly read, but I wasn't super interested by that. But because it involves the Kree, the Kree and the Skrulls and all that, like, obviously Captain Marvel had to be probably a big part of that. It makes sense for it to travel through her book, the Empire event type stuff. Just because I didn't read that and wasn't overly interested in it, I wasn't as invested in this title like I have been previously. I've just really been enjoying more so of the smaller adventures, learning about Captain Marvel, Carol Danvers, and her life. I think Kelly Thompson has a great voice for the character, and her cast of like characters in the book, like her friends and her life in this title. And I've really dug a lot of the stuff Kelly Thompson has been writing over the last few years. So this is no exception. It is a good book, but probably one of the weaker volumes of the series, only because of the fact that it was a tie-in for me. If you read Empire and you enjoyed Empire, you might really like this one as well. But I'm sticking with it. I really like Captain Marvel. Next up, we got Hawkeye Freefall. This is an amazing, amazing under-the-radar book, I think. And if you didn't end up checking this out, definitely check this out. This is one of my biggest fun surprise reads that came out of Marvel this past year. I believe the single issue started coming out before, like, when the pandemic hit. And because of the fact that, comics stopped shipping for 6 weeks through Diamond, the comic distributor, they had to, like, basically when they did come back and start releasing issues again, the last couple of issues of this series, I think, were a little staggered. And by the time the trade paperback would just, like I said, just got released this past month, I had heard a lot of good things about this series going into it, and I was waiting a long time to read it. And it paid off. This is by Matthew Rosenberg, and he has a great voice for Hawkeye. If you liked any of the more recent Hawkeye series that have come out, probably since Matt Fraction breathed new life into the character years ago, I definitely would suggest checking this out. He's got, it's fun, funny, great art by Otto Schmidt, who also did another Archer book at DC when he did Green Arrow for the Rebirth series, which I didn't end up sticking with, but it's just funny seeing him draw yet another Archer in this title. But I really like his art style. He does a great job with this character, Matthew Rosenberg. Again, great voice for the character. It's kind of dark at times as well, this take on it. There was a few surprises along the way as well too. Honestly, this was just a hell of a lot of fun. Great art, great storytelling. Definitely check out Hawkeye Freefall if you're a fan of the character, or if you're just looking for a fun little miniseries that probably was under the radar for you from Marvel this past year. Next up, we got Spider-Woman Volume 1. This is the newest series from writer Carla Pacheco and Perry Perez, who is the artist on this. This collects Spider-Woman 1 to 5 in this volume. Now, this one, admittingly, I'm new to Carlo Pacheco as a writer. I'd heard really good positive things about this run. I was a huge fan of the Dennis Hopeless run on Spider-Woman, and I love the character. That all being said, I didn't love this volume, but I will give it another read over, only because, truth be told, this is one of those like nighttime reads where I was kind of reading in bed. The last couple issues, I maybe kind of spread through them quite a bit, and I don't know if I got everything that was exactly going on. It got very convoluted. I felt those last couple of issues, you had to know a lot of history about the character. They kind of threw a lot of reveals in the last couple of issues of this. I'm trying to talk about it without spoiling it too much for anybody. The art was fantastic with Perry Perez throughout, though. And in the first couple of issues, I did quite enjoy it. It felt fun. I think she had a good take on the character Jessica Drew, but then as I went further into it, I didn't love it as much. But I'm gonna think read the last couple of issues over again, because I've read such positive reviews on this and I love the character so much. I'm gonna give it one more chance. If it doesn't click with me though, that's okay. I probably won't end up picking up the second volume, but it was okay, I would say, at this point for me. Next up, we got Die Volume 3, written by Karen Gillan, art by Stephanie Hans. This is published by Image Comics. I really liked this book. The first volume really surprised me because I wasn't sure if it was going to be a concept or genre I would be in love with. It's fantasy. It's kind of like if you mix something like, think of It, like where all the kids, Stephen King's It, where they all have like a traumatic experience. They all share like some traumatic experience maybe when they were young. And like Jumanji, where they get sucked into the game, but in this they get sucked into a game of Dungeons and Dragons, and then they all end up going on with their lives, and then as adults now, again with all their own kind of problems that they have going on in their own lives, they come together and they end up going back into this Dungeons and Dragons type game. And one of their friends, I guess they ended up losing him way back when, and it turns out he ends up in the Dungeons and Dragons world waiting for them. He's the reason they end up going back in, and it kind of just goes from there. They end up living their lives in this Dungeons and Dragons game. I've never played Dungeons and Dragons. I'm not a big role-playing fantasy fan, really, of role-playing games even. Haven't really played them enough to really, comment on that. So I wasn't sure if I would be interested in the type of story that they're telling here. Karen Gillan being a huge RPG fan from what I've been told. So, but that being said, I have enjoyed it. The second volume almost lost me at one point, and I also felt that during the third, to be honest. But before each volume completes, they got me right back into it, interested again. Just because I think every time I revisit this, ever since the first volume, how much I love that one, surprisingly, just because I went in with low expectations. I feel that when I do revisit the world, it takes me a little bit to kind of get back into it, get back into the swing of things, the relationship of these characters and where they're kind of headed. But I really, really enjoyed this by the end of this volume, so I'm going to stick with it for now. So if you're into kind of Dungeons and Dragons, into fantasy, or Karen Gillan as a writer, I haven't loved everything he's done, truthfully. But this has been pretty solid. Die. That's Die from Image Comics. Next up, we got Moonshine Volume 4 that came out this past month. This is from the team of 100 Bullets, Eduardo Rizzo, and on art, and Brian Azzarello writing duties. I love this team from 100 Bullets. They write kind of crime comics, really great, and noir type storylines, I would say. This is probably maybe, I know they did that Spaceman miniseries after 100 Bullets, and maybe a couple of smaller things here and there for DC. I know they did some Batman together. Moonshine is a crime werewolf story, hence I guess the name Moonshine, because it also takes place in the South and there is talk about moonshine, but then also because of the moon, the werewolves and all that. It's basically about like like mobsters, like I guess from New York, like Italian mobsters that end up back in Prohibition times. I guess they get caught up in like the hooch selling business. They try to get some moonshine from the South. One of the guys gets turned into a werewolf, and then it kind of goes from there. And at this point in the story, all the characters are all kind of all over the place that you were introduced to in the first couple of volumes, and it's just progressing with their certain storylines in their own direction. So Eduardo Rizzo, always a great artist. I really love like the way he spots the blacks, like the way he kind of he catches the moodiness of all the shading on the page with all the characters. He draws great looking women. He also has started doing something where he's been working with like it seems like painted like watercolor on some of his artwork. At least that's what he makes it look like, and that's really well done. He's been kind of doing that on the last couple projects that I've seen him on, and that's kind of looked really cool because I hadn't seen him change up his art style for quite a while. So yeah, Volume 4, if you've been if you haven't read this series, maybe just pick up the first volume, try it out. I think it's a good mix of kind of horror and crime, and it's a little bit different for Eduardo Rizzo and Brian Azzarello, I would find, in that sense. It's got a little bit of different genre mashing going on, and having a good time with it. Now we got Eternals, which they re-released in a new brand new original hardcover, oversized hardcover from Marvel, because of the fact that the Eternals movie, I guess, was set to be released soon, but obviously, like all movies, got pushed back this year due to the pandemic. They've released a lot of released and re-released a lot of Eternals material this past month from Marvel. I've read this before. This is the one that's written by Neil Gaiman with art by John Romita Jr. The story's okay. I'm a fan of John Romita Jr. at times. Again, somebody who I feel like today, for instance, when he's been doing his artwork with Bendis on Superman, where it hasn't been that great. He's been inconsistent from project to project as of late, I would find. But during this time when he was at Marvel, I enjoyed, for the most part, some of the things that he was working on. So I didn't own this story. I think I read it in issues back in the day, and I wanted to have a collected edition of it. And I felt John Romita Jr.'s art was good enough during this period to warrant the oversized hardcover. So I'm going to revisit it. I've read it before, but I would just say, you know, don't rush out for this one. It's not like the best story from what I remember, but if you're a fan of Neil Gaiman or you're a fan of John Romita Jr., there's big names on this, right? So maybe you'll like it. Or even if you're a huge fan of the Eternals, I've only read a couple things of the Eternals. So, but I'm looking forward to revisiting this one. Next up, we got Claws. This is the third deluxe oversized hardcover from Boom Studios. This is the Life and Times of Santa Claus. Last year, they came out with an oversized one-shot of this idea of Claws, where it's kind of giving you a calendar throughout December, and the story was told through like full-page spreads in this direction. Kind of like almost like a, you know, like a calendar to go through the days of Christmas, and each kind of scene, each day represented like something else, a different moment. And this is the Grant Morrison written series with art by the amazing Dan Mora on art. I love Dan Mora's art. He's done a lot of things. He's also working with Kieran Gillen on a book, Once in Future, through Boom Studios right now currently as well. But this is basically the first Claus book, was a origin series of sorts of Santa Claus written by Grant Morrison. I mean, yes, you can't get better than that. And I always pick up these deluxe oversized hardcovers of the series when they do come out. I revisit them around Christmas time. This one came out the week of Christmas this year, which is the third of the mini series of Claws, most recent one that came out last year. Every other year they kind of do one, and then they release the hardcover the following year, it seems like, at this point. But yeah, if you have never read these series, they're, like I said, Santa Claus written by Grant Morrison with fantastic art. Check out the first miniseries, because I still think that's the best one so far. But there's about three of these oversized hardcovers so far, and they've all been really good. I always look forward to rereading those. Next up, probably one of the best things I've read this year, actually, is Reckless by Ed Brubaker and Sean Phillips, the powerhouse comics team who just keeps pumping out fantastic work, even at this point of working together for so long and at this point of their careers, after so many other great things that they've done. I'm a huge fan of Ed Brubaker and Sean Phillips. They just do crime noir comics, right? And, you know, they've dabbled into some other genres as well, too. I mean, I really loved the Fade Out. I love Killer Be Killed. Reckless. This is the first in a series of new OGNs that they're going to be releasing only like in this type of format, not in single issue format, throughout the next year. I think they've already solicited the second volume in the Reckless series with this character, basically, that is featured in the Reckless stories. This was amazing. I mean, and they even released another book called Pulp, if you guys haven't checked that out, another OGN this past year through Image Comics, and wrapped up their newest criminal run. So, I mean, this year has just been amazing for them. I think Sean Phillips is actually looking a little looser in this Reckless book, which is, it's not that much different, but a little bit different if you're used to kind of Sean Phillips' style. I think he kind of got a little bit more loose than usual in this, which still looks great. Again, it's just crime comics done right, and always really great stuff, and one of the best things they've done in a long line of great things. One of the best things I read this year, Reckless. Definitely check this out, especially if you're new to these guys' work. This is, you don't need to have read anything else they've done to read this. Speaking of gorgeous artwork, we got Adventure Man Volume 1, the oversized hardcover from Image Comics. This is kind of like a French album edition size book. I think the Dodsons, the artists, that might be French, or they've released similar album size edition, like European books that are kind of like this size. It's a little bit wider, not as tall as like the deluxe editions that we have in our market. But the art just really, really needs it in this format. I've been reading this in single issues too and having a lot of fun with it. But the Dodsons on art, I'll show you a little bit of it. If you aren't familiar with Terry Dodson and Rachel Dodson, the husband-wife team, then definitely get yourself familiar with them. Honestly, very clean-lined artwork. Terry Dodson just draws beautiful women, beautiful people, period. It's just some of the best stuff I've seen him do. He kind of just gets continuously better and better. And again, in this oversized format, it looks great. So yeah, it's about a pulp adventurer or a woman discovering that these pulp adventures were possibly real. So if you're not into pulp, I'm not a huge pulp comics fan. Like all like the old pulp type characters that they keep bringing new takes on out. This is like an original idea, but is of course based on like other types of pulp characters that Matt Fraction, the writer, kind of bases it on. But I would give it a shot still, because depending on the art team, depending on the writer, I sometimes don't mind reading a pulp type style comic book. And this is kind of based in the real world, and it's someone discovering that these pulp characters may have actually existed at one point in time. So it doesn't feel like you're going straight into a pulp comic book all the time throughout this, like in the narrative. So definitely check this out if you haven't yet. This was really great. And then I also read manga, not just Western comics. I read manga as well. And I have a couple volumes of manga that I picked up this month that I've also read that I wanted to talk to you guys about. First up is Golden Kamuy. I believe that's how you pronounce it. This is published by Viz Media. This is volume 19. This is probably my favorite ongoing current manga series that I pick up and read. It's really interesting. It's got like a bunch of different genres mashed together in this. I would say there's action, it's violent, there's hilarious moments, you learn about history and you learn about food. It's like a bunch of genres that like exist in other mangas and stuff, but they usually only kind of focus on maybe one of those type of things. But in this one, it has everything. Like it's adventurous. It's honestly like it's just a bunch of different genres mashed together and with great art and great characters and many characters. Like there's like 20 characters in this that you've been introduced to that were still kind of going through their ongoing adventures throughout each volume of this. This is a great series. I'm not going to go too much into the plot here for you guys today, but again, like any of these, try out the first volume if you're new to manga, and maybe aren't familiar with maybe some of the things that the genre has to offer. This has it all, man. I think you'd really be into this. I've said it before. I think this is kind of like if you like Quentin Tarantino movies or things like of that nature, I think you'd like something like Golden Kamuy. So Next up, we got Junji Ito's Ramina. Now, I pick up all the Junji Ito releases. I'm very biased because I really love all of his work. But I got to say, this one was left me a little bit wanting. And this is his first like one that they've released here in English that kind of they said is more so like a science fiction story as opposed to a horror story. Junji Ito, of course, known for a lot of his horror manga that they've re-released in these nicer hardcovers through Viz Media over the past couple years. And every year now they've been releasing at least two or three new releases, or at least as long as as fast as they can translate them and send them over here, right? Because he's still a very current working today artist in Japan. A lot of people that don't even read manga have gotten into Junji Ito, it seems like, over the last couple of years that I've talked to, because they're more so into horror or they hear about how good this guy is. So he's definitely, I think, broken into the more of the mainstream comic book readers than anybody in more recent years, I would find, that, you know, maybe unless you watch animes and you kind of got into manga that way. But a lot of people read his stuff that I know that, again, don't read comics, don't read other mangas even. But this one, this was okay. It was still good. And again, like I said, I'm biased because I really love his work. I like owning all of his work. I pick up every book he comes out with here that they've released and translated. And most of them are all really great. This one was just okay. I don't want to say it's just because it was a little bit of science fiction in it, because again, there was definitely horror elements in this still, as much as they tried to say it was like his like first science fiction thing release. It was just okay. It wasn't his best thing that I've read. Still good. If you're a fan of Junji Ito like me and you want to kind of own all of his releases, pick it up. But I think you're going to find that, at least for me, it's not as good as some of his other stuff. And then last but not least, we got Hellsing, the Deluxe Edition Volume 2. Dark Horse has been re-releasing this manga series in these nice oversized Deluxe Edition, like faux leather books that I've really enjoyed picking up. I've been picking up the Berserk editions and reading it for the first time, as well as the Blade of the Immortal books that they've been doing in this format. Now, of course, Dark Horse originally released these in 10 smaller single manga volumes. These oversized hardcovers, they've been releasing in about 3 to 4 volumes in each one of these hardcovers that they've released so far. So there's going to be one more volume that will complete the set of Hellsing, because like I said, it's only about 10 volumes originally in English. But to get it in this format, the story's just been okay. Again, I've been kind of keeping it up with this one mostly for the art. The art is fantastic by Koda Hirano, the writer and artist of this book, Hellsing. I gotta say, in this oversized format, it's quite the treat. And the story was just okay. I felt the second volume was better than the first volume, though. It's Nazis versus vampires, so it's fairly simple of a concept, but I just feel that like the story, the way it's written, isn't the best. I will say, like, the arts definitely keep me interested, and the story was a little bit better in the second volume. So as we're going into the third volume, not a huge commitment. I'm looking forward to wrapping the series up. That's Hellsing from Dark Horse Comics. Definitely check that out. All right, and now we're going to actually move on to a couple of books that did come out in December of 2020 that I didn't end up reading. All those other ones I had read, so that's why I was commenting on them. Another manga here, we got Naoki Urasawa's 20th Century Boys Volume 10 Perfect Edition. These Perfect Editions, they've been re-releasing them. Again, they came out in single volumes, about 22 volumes, and then I think there was the epilogue, the 21st Century Boys, that was a 2-volume set that kind of finished off the series. I've read up to about the 5th or 6th volume of these Perfect Editions, and with these Perfect Editions, they re-release them in these nicer formats. They're really nice on the shelf, and it's more material. They're thicker in each one, about the same size as the other mangas that they came out with, though. Normally, these Viz Signature ones, like these Perfect Editions, they are a little bit bigger than the smaller release versions, but previous to this, they had released all those 20th Century Boys in the same kind of size format book. So if you're looking for a bigger size format manga, like, it's not going to be like this deluxe edition kind of hardcover that I showed you, but it is bigger than some of the other smaller manga volumes that are kind of like this, right? So Naoki Urasawa, I've read Pluto, I've read Monster, I'm a huge fan of his. I have never read all of 20th Century Boys. I know, shame on me, people who are familiar with his work or this series have all told me that this is probably the best thing that he's done. I have really been enjoying reading them, but I kind of fell behind. I've read about five or six of these Perfect Edition volumes. There's only probably going to be about two more of these Perfect Edition volumes to come out. I think the 11th one is going to conclude the 22 volumes of this series, because, like I said, there's two per volume. And then there's the volume 12 that comes after that will probably collect, I think, both volumes of the 21st Century Boys, which will wrap this series up. So it's probably going to be about 12 volumes all said and done. So I might have to go back and start rereading everything again, just so it's fresh in my mind, because there's a lot of secrets to be revealed and things that he's kind of been teasing throughout this series, and it's been great, and I'm really looking forward to finishing that. And last off, for things that came out this past month that I picked up, this is the Thor Epic Collection Volume 19, The Thor War. These epic collections that Marvel puts out are a great way to collect a character's history, any line of characters that you really enjoy in the Marvel Universe. I would definitely suggest checking out this line of books if there is a character that you love. They're kind of collecting like a lot of these bigger characters' histories all the way from the start of their series till somewhere around the 90s. I think it's like some up till about maybe the mid-90s, I think, is where the farthest that they've kind of reached so far with these epic collections. They don't come out in order, so like, you know, this is volume 19, but then like the next one that comes out might be like something that's like volume 4, but they are collecting them all like chronologically throughout their history. So this is the Tom DeFalco Ron Friends run of Thor, which I've heard really great things about. There's about one more volume that's going to be coming in 2021 that will cap off the end of his run, and all the rest of the run has been collected so far. There's one volume I think that's out of print that I still have to find, but then after that I'm going to be able to sit down and read the whole run here, and that's the only reason I've been kind of waiting for this all to be released, because I've heard good things about his run, and I look forward to checking that out. And lastly, of the books that came out this past month, December 2020, to finish out the year, it's the Complete Hate box set by Peter Bagg. Now, this was released by Fantagraphics, and it's a nice box set that collects all of the Hate series written by Peter Bagg. You know, the indie series from the 90s that kind of revolves around Buddy Bradley, somebody who's like, I guess, lives in Seattle, at least at the start of it. So it kind of captures that whole like grunge era, like, you know, indie comics. I'm sure it's got, you know, the reason why it's called Hate. I mean, I've never read any Hate, but I've heard such good things about it, and it's a hard series to track down on the actual old single issues of, at least for a good price. So when they announced this box set, I jumped on it. So I'm really looking forward to checking that out. And, you know, I have 8 Ball by Fantagraphics box set, and I got Peter Bagg's Neat Stuff as well from them. So they just come out with these nice box sets, Fantagraphics, of like the older indie series that they've kind of produced that have been, you know, so many people have told me are great. So I'm really looking forward to reading that. Peter Bagg, of course, got more of a cartoonier style, and I haven't read too much of his work, to be honest, but I'm really looking forward to this. Okay, and then now we'll be getting into the books that I ended up picking up this month but didn't necessarily come out in December 2020. Some of these I read, some of these I'll be reading for the first time, and a couple of them I got for gifts. So this is Rubber Banded by Kyle Baker, the deluxe oversized hardcover from DC Comics that collects all of Kyle Baker's run that he wrote and drew of Plastic Man. I'm really, really looking forward to this. Look at this cool presentation on this book, too. This is actually got like an actual like plastic kind of rubber band that wraps around the book, and you have to like take it off to read it. Isn't that awesome? Like, it kind of gives that aesthetic of like it's actual, like, you know, hence the rubber banded kind of name for this. And this is the first time that the series has been collected all together. They came out with a paperback maybe in the 2000s. I had some of the issues of the series, but didn't collect the whole thing. And it was also very out of print, very hard to find. So I never bothered tracking that down, as well as the issues. So the fact that he actually released this, I've heard so many great things about this. The artwork kind of reminds me of like Ren and Stimpy, like the animation style. Again, very cartoony style. Really looking forward to checking this out, though, because, again, I've heard a lot of great things about this book, and I'm sure it will not disappoint. Okay, next up we got Batman Gotham by Gaslight, the deluxe edition hardcover. Of course, huge fan of Mike Mignola, the creator of Hellboy. I had to have this in oversized edition. I know they first announced an absolute for it, but they ended up canceling that and then coming out with this deluxe edition or hardcover. But I'm happy to have this. This also collects the, I think it's like the sequel, Batman Master of the Future, as well as a couple of miniseries that DC has brought out that take place in the same timeline as Gotham by Gaslight, and that's Countdown Presents The Search for Ray Palmer, Gotham by Gaslight number 1, as well as Convergence Shazam 1 and 2, which is written by Jeff Parker, art by Evan Doc Shaner. That was a really, I didn't really like Convergence overall, but that was one of the only miniseries I thought that was really solid. Maybe one or two of them were good, and that was one of them. That's the Shazam Convergence series, which they also end up in this timeline in. So, a lot of fun. Looking forward to checking this out again with this nice oversized art. Mike Mignola, if you're a fan of his, definitely check out Gotham by Gaslight if you have not. Next up, we got Batman Who Laughs. Sorry about that, guys. I mean, you know that there's also that other character that's running around the DC universe right now. But not to be mistaken, this is Batman, The Man Who Laughs, which is actually a Joker story that Ed Brubaker wrote, art by Doug Monkey. Again, had the trade paperback, but I wanted this oversized hardcover edition. And the bonus about this, again, because they had to pad it out because that story is not as long on its own, they also included two other Ed Brubaker stories that he wrote with Batman, and the one that I'm really looking forward to and checking out is the Batman Gotham Noir. I've read the single issue before, but that was an Elseworlds story that he actually did with Sean Phillips back in the day, one of the earliest collaborations at DC Comics, and it was not collected anywhere like an oversized format like this. I don't even think it was in the Gotham Central omnibus, I believe, so it's really cool to get that in this, him and Sean Phillips work on the Elseworlds Gotham Noir story, as well as the one that he did with Patrick Zerk or Made of Wood, which is really good. This is his stuff that he did through Detective Comics when he told this Joker story. So I'm really happy to have that. Next up, The Eternals. Once again, they came out with the actual omnibus by Jack Kirby. They re-released it this past month. It was previously, came out years and years ago for Marvel. When they re-released it this time around, they also included some 80s maxi series of The Eternals that I wasn't as interested in. And, omnibus being much more expensive than this complete collection trade paperback that they also re-released, I just figured this was good enough, so I ended up picking this up this month. I kind of passed on the omnibus on this one. Jack Kirby's run The Eternals, I heard, was not one of his best things that he kind of had done. I think it was around the time that he left Marvel, went to DC, did so much great work at DC after doing so much great work at Marvel, and then I believe this was him coming back to Marvel during that period of time that he ended up doing the Eternals, if I'm not mistaken. So I haven't heard great things about this period of Jack Kirby or this run on Eternals. I heard it's inferior to some of the other things he had done around that time, clearly, but he did so many great things. But I am still looking forward to checking it out. Again, I haven't read much Eternals. I am a fan of Jack Kirby's stuff, and I'm happy to have it in this complete collection paperback. And next up, I got these as gifts for Christmas, and that is Agents of Atlas, the complete collection, volume 1 from Marvel Comics, Jeff Parker series that he wrote years ago, a bunch of main series and a bunch of mini series that he did around that time with some great artists, Gabriel Hardman, Leonard Kirk's on here. Really looking forward to checking this out. I've heard a lot of great things, and I like Jeff Parker's writing. Seems like a fun concept. And I ended up getting this as a gift, and I had to go out and get number volume 2, because that completes the 2 volumes that are out as of right now. There may be one more volume worth of material that hopefully comes out one day, if I'm not mistaken, of Agents of Atlas stuff. They've actually relaunched the series, I think, this past year or two, and I think Greg Pak's writing it currently. Hopefully there'll be more collections, these complete collections of Agents of Atlas, because I think it's a really fun concept, and I'm looking forward to checking these out. And last but not least, another amazing gift I got this year for Christmas. I got Volume 2 of Dreadstar Omnibus. This is Jim Starlin's, basically a character he created, and it bounced around to a few different publishers. He ended up kickstarting these books, I think, sometime last year. And it actually comes in a box set version as well. But I ended up getting the individual Omnibus volume. There's about three Omnibuses in the set. I previously had Omnibus Volume 1 that I ended up picking up. So then I ended up getting the Volume 2 as a gift. And then I ended up going out and picking up Volume 3 as well to finish off the series. And all the actual spines, they actually line up. And they show like a, I don't know if you can see that, a picture as well. Like when they're in the box set, it looks pretty cool, I'm sure, like that as well. Oh, it would help that if I put them in order. There we go. So, yeah, pretty cool. I'm really looking forward to checking this series out. I'm a huge Jim Starlin fan. I actually read the first volume on the best of Worth of Material, so I know I like it. Dynamite released a few, a hardcover and a couple of paperbacks, you know, a long time ago, but then they stopped printing the collection and never ended up finishing it off. So the fact that he got this printed by someone called Ominous Press, I don't know if they're just a publisher that he ended up going to once the Kickstarter was successful in getting these printed out. I'm happy to have them. I'm happy to check out the whole series for the first time because, you know, Jim Starlin, all the Marvel Cosmic stuff he did, you know, Thanos that he created for them and everything else that he's done. And this seems like, after reading the first volume of Worth of Material, it seems very much in that same vein, but just his own character that he did outside of Marvel. So really looking forward to checking that out. All right, so that'll do it for today. I think I've talked enough there on on each and every book that I picked up through the month of December 2020. Please let me know what you thought of this video and how you may things maybe to improve the video moving forward, or you know, comments, things you might want me to talk about, maybe other things involving comics. I'll see how this goes, and then maybe I'll end up doing other comic videos eventually, maybe even a tour of my library. Yeah, so let me know. So I'm open to it. I'm hoping to at least do these monthly for now. So definitely check back next month. Subscribe to the channel, hit that like button, and let me know what you think. Thanks a lot, and thank you for checking this out.